help build an even bigger, stronger infrastructure that is based on that technology. The idea of nodes, the idea of meanwhile leases, meanwhile spaces that each in themselves can do whatever they need to do to solve their local problem. But as long as the infrastructure, the fundamental language, the HTML of our system, as long as that is in common if we use these projects, we can share resources, we can share best practice, we can share knowledge, we can share tactics. And it's the creation of this infrastructure that Respace was created for. And the conference that is coming up in February or March of next year will be very heavily focused on infrastructure. We're currently pursuing large spaces where we can store a lot of the materials that we're being given. What we would like to be able to do is centralized storing locations, which can provide for a number of different nodes in the area. Each node, the beauty of this system, I believe, is that each node itself can be. Am I running over? Okay. No worries. Each node itself can be, it doesn't have to be permanent. It can be temporary, it can be permanent. It can be almost anything it wants to be because the infrastructure supports it and will support it if it fails or if it succeeds. We need to build environments where humans can fail. I know that sounds crazy. I know that sounds crazy. Why would you want to do that? Why would you want to build environments where people can mess up? Because people mess up. That's what we do. Okay? We're not all perfect. In fact, I have yet to meet, apart from my mum, I have yet to meet one perfect person. Right? And she only ever said she was perfect, but she probably wasn't. The point is that we will make mistakes, and we need to encourage in environments where it's safe to make mistakes, people to experiment, people to push the boundaries, to not be slaves to worrying about where the dollar is going to come from, or whether they can make a mistake, or whether they're going to end up with a massive loan on their back because they slightly misjudged the niche market that they were attempting to go for. And I believe that this infrastructure, these areas, these recycled spaces, provide that perfect platform. And that would be a good moment to finish and ask if there's any questions.
Room and facility to put it in its correct. and it's important that projects are like that, they have that kind of, you know, specific to a location basis. So if we were to take, say, a large open green space and create a permanent growing project in there, bed all the people in the nomadic temporary spaces, then you have a system that actually does sustain. That actually, if and when my potential building back gets, you know, the planning commission or whatever it is, there will be no hard feeling. By that time, you should have 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, 9 more spaces for other groups to be able to smoothly carry on our work with their own energy and with their own directions. But as long as the community has options and access, we're not trying to build a utopia. That's not what this is about. This is just about getting an entire system that is predicated on waste to one world. Those of you who might remember one world syndrome, I never thought I would be a one, but actually that's probably what's happening. And it's that idea that we can. It's not perfect, it's not going to work forever, but we do live in this world, let's be realistic. A world where Subway throw away more food in a day than could feed the entire hungry family. I just want, just Subway, more food in a day, where Tesco's jump 1 million pounds of food a month. We live in that world. There's no point talking crap about it. There's no point going, oh, we should want to write that. Let's use it. Let's force Tesco's to give us their food before they jump and chop blue dye away. I've seen people, hungry people, eating blue food. Blue food because Tesco don't want them to have it because, what, they're going to get sued. I mean, it's nonsense. So this is the environment we live in. Sorry, I went on for a while.
My issue is that when did the initial inspiration kick off? Did you just walk across there and saw this building and decide, or did you have a kind of group session and think that we can have this, but how do you get around the bridge of inspiring the audience to hand it over and all of you that day?
I'll try and answer that really, really quickly. From my personal perspective, you know, Felix, Ned, everyone who's part of this group has their own reasons for getting into being part of it. From a personal perspective, about 6 years ago I moved in. I had a really bad time in my life and I moved into a place called 491 Gallery in Leytonstone. I was, at that time, I was quite successful. I was earning quite a lot of money. I had a really nice house, really nice car, not so nice girlfriend, clearly, it turns out. But at that point, you know, things were going quite well, and the bottom fell out of my world, and I ended up living in a squat. And I figured if it hadn't been for that squat, if it hadn't been for that couch that they let me sleep on for 6 months and sweep the floor as payment, if it hadn't been for that place, I wouldn't be here today. I'd be hanging from underneath one of those bridges by a bit of electric flex. And so, once I managed to put myself back together and get on my feet, it seemed to me to be the most important thing to do is to ensure somewhere at the very bottom, right there where there's nothing, you know, where there's just a big black hole, there's at least some kind of net. It didn't have to be made out of gold, it could be made out of recycled material, right? But there needs to be something at the very bottom for people to fall out of the pre-constructed strata that we have in our society. So that's where I came from. And in regards to this particular building, for a few years then I went around the squat scene, the activist scene, the protest scene, and tried to find the people who I felt would be similar to me in this idea. And luckily I met Phoenix and I met Ned and Joe and Mars and several people. And the inspiration comes from Mars, who came to the 491 Gallery a few years ago and told me a little bit about, you know, some of the work that she was doing. I own a minister of trees in the future, you know, that was planned for our architect and introduced me to the work from Charles as well. So I got a chance to see what that was all about. That led us to the point where a strategy was put into place, where we have facilities, we have sound equipment and lighting equipment, and so we gave them as much help to local charities who had me and in Waterford Forest and in Leeds then, if we possibly could. We said, we've got free spaces. You don't normally get access to free spaces. We have some. It's not perfect, it's not great. Come and use it. Let's see if we can benefit. We did the same with lighting and sound systems. And eventually that led to Jake getting in contact with myself and saying he knew Michael. He put me and Michael together and we just clicked. You know, he had the an idea, I had an idea, and they seemed to work well together. And thus, the hype was born.
Can I just say something briefly? The concept about recycling empty buildings is what part of what we're trying to get through with Free Spaces. See the logo that's been up there, recycle, rethink, renew, reuse. Something like, the figures go up and down every 5 years, but something like 1.5 million empty buildings in the UK. We recycle bottles, cans, glass, plastic, everything else. We should be recycling all of these empty building resources. And hopefully what we're doing here at the Hive inspires people of all levels of society to cooperate and start to use, you know, these resources that we have to rehouse people and projects and community space and get that concept of, you know, recycling, you know, spaces for the community to create a lot of spaces.
And it's sure. A great point. It's just not,
as you said, it's not about bottles and cans, it's what we're told to recycle. It's about buildings, it's about spaces. It's also about people, because the amount of people get thrown out of scrap because they're too old for working, or they're too ill for this, or they're too sick for that. They still have a huge amount of knowledge and ability and skills, right? But nowhere to be able to express that. And so this concept allows that to happen. And, you know, 1 in 3 talented people who aren't well have contributed every bit as much as everybody else has to the building of this building. So it is about recycling. But, you know, I don't want to say recycling because that's not important to shred.
Like Jim was saying, about cultural spaces is so important.
Recycling skills, that's very smart.
We've seen over 20 years of setting up community centres in various empty buildings that a magic happens when you create a space where young and old and people of all cultures can mix and share skills and knowledge. And it doesn't take that much funds. You can run a lot of these things on donation, self-funded. And what we really need is the space where communities can gather, create that central cultural space and interlink cultural spaces and community spaces, environment spaces, art spaces. And it creates a happier and a healthier society because people come and share their skills, the young and the old, mix together and